What we're going to do now is we're going to make a traditional Sunday tomato sauce. Traditional for what my family is used to and what my parents and grandparents taught me. My family comes from a town in Italy called Gaeta, which is in Lazio, which is the region that includes Rome and Gaeta and many of the little cities that go between Rome and Gaeta. It's on the west coast of the peninsula. It's an ocean town. It's actually a peninsula. And it's rich in seafood, vegetables, not so rich in beef, poultry, and pork, but at the same time, they have regions inside the mountains where they can get all of that. So what I'm going to give you today is my take on traditional Sunday sauce. I'm going to make it without meat. The way I was taught by my grandparents and my parents was that we don't mix garlic and onions together, okay? There's a saying in Gaeta that says if you mix onions and garlic together in the sauce, they argue with one another, which makes sense because they're both very strong flavors. Traditionally, garlic is used more with fish sauces or white sauces. Onion is used more when you want to use meat or poultry in your sauce. Today, we're going to use the onion version because I like to make tomato sauce for Sundays just the sauce itself, and then add meats later on, like meatballs or sausage or bracciola or beef tips or whatever I plan on using. So the basic ingredients are the same: olive oil, plum tomatoes, which I have pressed through a sieve to remove seeds and skin, and I'll explain that reason in a minute. I use some tomato paste to add some body and flavor to it. I also, of course, have the standard basil in this case. With beef or meats, basil is the herb of choice in my region. And we use some white wine, which is basically anything you would drink that's a dry or semi-dry wine. In this case, we're using a Sauvignon Blanc, which I make myself. All right, now some people may disagree with me on this, but then again, we're making sauce based on the preference of the people who are eating it. I like to add a little bit of sugar to my sauce to make it a little sweeter. But what I do is I adjust the sweetness of the sauce based on the acidity of the tomato. Remember that every can of tomato is going to have a different level of sweetness or acidity. So I adjust the sweetness as I go. Typically, toward the end of the cooking process is when I make my final adjustments. And actually, I have everybody taste it and say, hey, is there anything missing? And there's nothing wrong with that, because what it does is it brings everybody's preference into the sauce and everybody's happy when it's time to eat. It's time to strain the tomatoes. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take the plum tomatoes, send them through a strainer, in this case a French chinois. And the reason I use this is because I can use my hands to press the tomatoes through the strainer. You can also use a regular strainer. You can use a food mill. Or you can use a blender, grind everything down, and send the material through a strainer then. This, for me, is just quicker and easier, and I get a feel for when I've gotten all the juice out of the tomato. We're using plum Italian tomatoes. Now, notice it doesn't say San Marzano on there. San Marzano is a region where everyone remembers that they come from that region because it's near the Vesuvius, and the ground is different. The tomatoes do taste a little different. These are just about as good. If you can't get San Marzano, don't be afraid. But what you're looking for is a good, peeled, imported Italian tomato. What we're going to do carefully, so I don't get my clothes all dirty, is to put the tomato into the sieve. Don't throw the can away just yet. Oops. Up like that. Leave this to the side. Now you notice it'll come with basil. We don't want that basil in there, so we're going to strain that out too. And all I do is I just press it through. You can see how thick the tomato actually is, which is nice, which means that this sauce is not going to have to cook as long as some of the more watery versions you might get occasionally. Remember, the tomatoes are a natural product, so they're going to be either thick or thin or somewhere in between, depending on the weather they were grown in, the ground they were grown in, and how long they were left to ripen. My mother always said, as long as you wash your hands, you're bringing character to the food which comes from you. So remember to wash your hands, because you want to bring the right character to the food, nothing extraneous or dirty. Okay, I think I've got this pretty much where I want it to be. At $3 a can, you don't want to lose that. Put a little bit of water in there. Remember, water is not a bad thing, because you have to cook this for a while, so the water helps the tomato to cook. But you don't want to overwhelm it with water, because the more water you put in, the longer it has to cook, and the more tendency you have to have a bitter sauce. Okay, we're going to cook now, or at least we're going to get ready to cook. Organization, cleanliness, understanding what you're going to do and when you're going to do it is important when you cook, because you don't want to spend time looking for things. So we've done here what the French called mise en place. Italian, mettere a posto. In English, put it in their place. I've got the oil, I've got my onions and tomato paste ready to go. We're going to work with those first. Then we go with our pressed tomato and puree, and then we add our accoutrements, which would be the wine, the salt and the pepper, the herb, and maybe some sugar. First thing I do, obviously, you need heat. So I get the pan warmed up, or hot actually, so that I can then add the oil to the pan. What we want is the pan to be hot enough that when we add the oil in, you can actually see it glistening rather than waiting for it to heat up in the pan. Why? Because when I add the onions, I want them to come to a sizzle right away. One thing that I forgot to mention earlier is please use fresh, good ingredients. My grandmother used to say, what you put in is what you get out. So what I use is maybe what amounts to 2 to 3 tablespoons of good extra virgin olive oil. Some people use lighter oils like vegetable oil and canola oil. I go with the traditional extra virgin. You can see that the oil is now pretty hot. Okay, it's glistening and it's moving around. How do you know it's hot enough? Easy. Hear that? Okay, the onion is sizzling. Cut back on the heat a bit. You don't want to burn the onion. This is about what is equivalent of one small sweet onion diced. I use Vidalia onions or sweet yellow onions because they give some sweetness to the sauce. I traditionally do not cook with red onion. You see how quickly that happened? I have the heat down to about medium high at this point, and I just am very careful to stir this around. We want to get the onions translucent, but not burned. Once you burn the onion, you start to introduce hints of bitterness to the sauce. This thing came from my mother-in-law. Yeah, I even have something from my mother-in-law here. You can see she cooked a lot with it, and the way it's worn out was in such a way that she used to constantly work around the perimeter of the pan, which is great because with that point on there, I can actually get into the corners. I let no one use this. This is my special wooden spoon. Tomato paste is already a fairly intense flavor, and it gives the sauce a little bit of an earthy taste. What I do is I just put a little extra virgin olive oil in a spot, and then what I'll go from there and just add the tomato paste directly on that hot oil. Yeah, you're going to get it on your hands and all that kind of stuff. Again, don't be afraid to use your hands. Now, this is the equivalent of 1 6-ounce can of Italian tomato paste. Okay, so now we want this to toast a little bit. And you'll know that it's toasting. It'll start to turn a bit of color. And you can see the caramelization taking place. Keep the onions happy. Now, the reason I dice them is because they will melt into the sauce. Now, I just get everything mixed in together at this point. And you're going to say, well, there's stuff stuck to the bottom. Mm-hmm. It is, and that's what you're looking for. That's where the flavor comes from. These are the strained plum tomatoes. You'll hear the sizzle, which is actually the process of deglazing. This is what is 2 cans of 35 ounces of Cento peeled plum tomatoes. I usually do this with even more than that, but we're just doing this for demonstration today. Again, don't waste anything. You want a little bit of water to cook with so the tomato cooks, but you don't want to overwhelm it with water. So what I do, a little bit of water there. A little bit of water here. Don't waste good food. If my mother were here, she'd be scraping whatever I left behind. One of the things you want to do that's very important, I learned this from my mother, is that you want to get the sauce to a simmer rapidly and then cut back, rather than bring it up slowly and let it cook forever. So we're going to bring this to medium, high to high, and we're going to add some more of the ingredients. The first thing I'm going to add is the passata, or the puree. Some people use canned tomato puree, which I tend not to use because I'm not so sure they've removed all of the bitterness from the seeds and everything. The Italians are very fussy when they do this. They're very clean on how they prepare their purees. Here's where the wine comes in. Now, some people don't use wine. Some people do. In my region of the peninsula, we do. Typically white wine. In other areas, red wine is used. In some areas, just water. The wine adds a little bit of flavor to it, a little fruitiness, and some sweetness. And this is how we get all of the puree. I can actually get a feeling for how bitter or sweet the sauce is going to be right from the beginning by testing what the tomatoes themselves taste like before I even start cooking. Fairly sweet, a touch acidic. So I'm going to bang off on the sugar a little bit at the beginning and add later if I need it. Actually, even salt and pepper isn't bad right now, and I haven't added any if you noticed. The tomatoes have a pretty nice natural flavor to them, but I'm going to add a bit of salt. Again, not heavily, because I can always adjust later. And I use plain salt, not iodized. I don't like iodized salt, so you can use regular plain salt, you can use sea salt, fine sea salt, or you can even use kosher salt, all of which contain no iodine. I like pepper. I think a lot of people in my family like pepper, so I'll add some pepper right now. This is fresh ground black pepper that I prepared ahead of time. And if you want, you can even add some chili pepper here, crushed chili pepper, but for Sunday sauce, I typically don't do that. I will do that when I make a marinara sauce for fish. And by the end of the process, the color of the sauce should actually be this color, which means you haven't overcooked it, hasn't turned brown or purple or anything that indicates you've overcooked the sauce. Notice I have it on high and I keep stirring. And here's my favorite herb. Fresh out of the garden, fresh basil. And you can do it the French way or the Italian way. You can chop the heck out of it and chiffonade it, which Italians don't do that. Italians like to see what they put in their food, so they tend to just naturally get the oils of the basil out by just pulling it apart manually. The difference from Parisian cooking and traditional Italian cooking is Parisians like to chop things up, which is fine, because they like to use more sauces and cream sauces, so they don't want you to see everything that's in there. And that's not in a bad way, it's just their preference. But if more peasant cooking, like the Italian cooking, and even peasant regions of France, things are done manually, because probably they didn't have the tools to do all the work that they needed to do to chiffonade. So now, that's your basil. I will adjust that later also. Trick now, you can also, if you look at the sides of the pot, after I stir this, you can see that the boiling is starting to take place. All right, as I had said earlier, I've got the sauce on high heat. You can see it's come to a boil. That took all of about maybe 5 to 8 minutes, enough time to get me to clean up all the dishes and utensils I used earlier. And what's left is just the adjustment, the salt, the pepper, and the basil. I'll give this a quick stir. You can see that it's cooking already, so you will see that this will form a crust on the sides as it cooks down. My mother used to get mad at me because I would never do this part. She said, no, that's flavor. Put it in there. I always thought it would make it bitter, but she was right. Okay, so now we go from a high heat to a medium to medium low. And you can adjust this as you go. As long as you continue to simmer so that the water that's in there will evaporate and that the alcohol from the wine will evaporate. Now remember I said this tasted kind of sweet from the beginning. That will change as the sauce cooks. And how long is it going to cook? Probably no more than an hour. And I can tell that by the way it sets up or its thickness develops. And again, a lot of cooking is by eye. It's not always by time. It's going to depend on the quality of the tomato, how thick it was to begin with. And you saw that these were pretty thick and I didn't add a lot of added liquid. And every 10 minutes or so, come over, give it a stir so nothing sticks. And in about an hour, we'll check to see if it's done. Okay, it's time to check the sauce. We're about 20 to 25 minutes into the process. You can really start to smell the flavor and the development of the sauce itself. And you can see that the color hasn't changed very much. It's still red like tomato, which means that it's cooking at a good process time, a good process temperature, and it's not getting burned. Now you'll hear me use the word process a lot. I'm a chemist. And I was a process chemist in my days, so that's the word I use a lot. I'm into process. Okay, so now we're going to give this a quick taste. Remember I said the flavors will change with time. I'm just going to put my... Oh, look at that. You can actually see it coating the spoon now, which is a good indication. You know, the seasoning is still good. The sweetness is still where it should be. I may not have to adjust this much at all. So we'll let it go for another 20 to 30 minutes, stirring a couple of times in between. And we'll come back then and see what it tastes and looks like. Okay, we've finished the sauce, turned it off a little while ago. You can take a peek at it. You can see that it's thickened up nicely, but it's not super thick. The color is exactly where I want it to be. You can see those little pieces of basil that I put in there. And we tasted it. I just cleaned the spoon, so I'm going to give it a little taste. And to be honest with you, other than the initial seasoning, we've done nothing to it. So it came out exactly the way I wanted it. Now, what do I do with this? I can do a couple of things. I can let it cool off and put it into individual containers. Usually I use quart containers and put it in the freezer once it's cooled off. Or I can use some of it, which we're going to do later, to eat with the pasta that we're making, and then save the rest. If you feel like making pizza, you can use this on pizza. Some people like it with garlic. Fine, make it with garlic. Or add garlic powder or fresh garlic when you make pizza. So you can do just about anything you want with this that deals with making pastas, pizza, or stromboli, or anything else that you'd like. Or just drink it, because it is pretty good. We're going to leave this at room temperature for a little while. Let it cool down without the lid. We don't want extra water getting back in there by the condensation off the lid. This should last you a few servings along the way here.